a great program today with Pastor Myles Munroe from the Bahamas. Whoa, I'm glad the man of God is ready to go. Thank you. You know, I love coming to the Bahamas, and I love being with Dr. Myles Munroe. He's a mighty man of God and a great Bible teacher. I told him this morning he's witty, very smart. He pulls things out of the Bible nobody else can pull out. He can find things, brother, that nobody else can find. And I'm really grateful to you because, you know, the Lord has used you to bless lives by the millions around the world. And by the way, mine included.
Thank you.
And I love you.
It's good to be back.
Oh, I love you. Come on, give me another big, big God bless you.
Good to be back.
I am very, very interested in discussing rediscovering the kingdom.
Yes.
This is one of the most important matters we can talk about. Saints, God is moving mightily around the world, and I believe the kingdom of God is being declared again.
Yes.
Around the world.
Yes.
Now, Pastor, when you say you're rediscovering the kingdom, what do you mean?
Well, you can only rediscover something that was lost, and I believe we lost it. I was shocked to discover, when you read the four Gospels, that the only focus of Jesus, the only message that Jesus Christ preached, talked about, and explained was this kingdom of heaven and kingdom of God. And I grew up in the religious environment all my life and heard very little, and most of the time nothing, about the kingdom of God. I heard about faith, I heard about belief, I heard about deliverance, I heard about healing, I heard about Holy Spirit, but there was no emphasis, no contact with this concept of the kingdom. And I even went to college, I have a degree in theology, and there was not one class on the only thing that Jesus preached, which is the kingdom of God. So I was graduated with a degree in theology and never had a class on what Jesus preached.
Now, you know, when you say the kingdom, people have all kinds of ideas.
Sure.
So what does the Bible mean by the kingdom?
You know, one of the most important things I talk about in this book is that whenever you're going to communicate with someone, the most important thing in communication is concepts. If I want to talk to you and make sure you understand me, I have to make sure that the same concepts I possess in my mind are the ones you possess. Because if I use a concept that is not the same in your mind, then when I use a word to communicate that concept, you will get a misconception. So the key to communication is having the same concepts. When you use, therefore, the terminology like kingdom, the question is, what does he mean? What did he mean? Right. Let me take it back to the beginning. When Adam fell, according to biblical chronology in the Bible, man basically fell 7,000 years ago, chronologically speaking from Scripture. Now, we know the earth may be older than that. We're not sure how old the earth is. It may be millions of years old. We don't know that. But as far as the life of humanity on earth, based on this book,
yeah,
7,000 years ago, man was created, placed on this earth, and then man fell. He disobeyed God. Now, here's I found something very strange. The first description God gives about man in the Bible is found in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. And he's talking to all human beings watching this program. He said, let us make man in our own image and in our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish, the birds, the cattle, over all the earth and everything that creeps upon the ground. Now, what's important here is two things. One, the word man is a plural word. He was not making just one person. He was making a species. That's why he used the word them. This word ish, as we define it in the Hebrew, is a plural word. He was saying, let's create a species in our own image. The word image means nature or moral character. Mm. That means every spirit being that is called man today has God's nature and moral character. He's not acting like it most of the time, but he possesses the genetics for it. Then God says, here's why I created the species. Let them have dominion. Now, Pastor Benny, here's the shocking reality. When I did my research, the word dominion in the Hebrew language is the word mamlakak. It's a very interesting word. We don't use it at all in English, of course. But this word mamlakak, that we translate dominion, is the exact word for kingdom. What God gave Adam, therefore, was mamlakak. The word mamlakak means kingdom. Kingdom means a ruler dominating a territory. That's what a king is. A king is a ruler that dominates a domain. The territory is called a domain. The king is called the king. So when a king is with his domain, it is called a king domain or a kingdom. So when God gave Adam dominion over the earth, he was giving Adam kingship over a territory called earth.
Right.
Therefore, rulership is the purpose for man. Not what we call worship, but rulership. See, worship has to do with relationship. Rulership has to do with the mandate. We're so busy worshiping, we're not affecting the earth. We're not dominating the planet. And that's why there's so much ungodliness rampant in the world, because the church has lost the mandate, and they are so busy preparing to go to heaven, they have no motivation to impact earth.
Wait, you said they lost the mandate. In other words, they are not clear on their position.
And their assignment.
Wow.
The word mamlakak is important. Let them have kingdom over the earth. Now, if mamlakak is the first thing God gave the human race, dominion, kingdom over the earth,
yes,
then that reveals God's motive, God's intent, and God's purpose for humanity, to have dominion over the earth. That means to manage, to lead, to govern, to control this planet, to look after this planet for him. You see, you cannot be a king without territory.
Absolutely right.
You cannot rule nothing. He had to rule something.
Exactly.
And so when Adam was created, you would notice that God created the earth first. The earth was made before Adam was released. Now, Adam existed before the earth, because the Bible says we were in him before the world began. We were in him.
Right.
But God knew that he was going to release a spirit being that would be a king, a ruler, and you can't rule without territory. That's why the Bible begins with this statement, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And then he made everything perfect. He gave it the water, the mountains, the trees, the animals, the insects, the oxygen, the nitrogen. And then he says, this is good. Then he said, now let us create man.
What you're saying is he built a kingdom for a king.
Thank you. He built the domain for the king. Exactly.
Wow, wow.
So when he released Adam, Adam was given kingdom. When Adam fell, that means disobeyed God, Adam lost whatever God gave him. Now, Adam was not given a religion. So when Jesus came to earth, here's the question. If Jesus came to earth to replace what Adam lost or to restore what Adam lost, then one way to find out what Adam lost is to study what Jesus bought. Because whatever he brought back to earth was to restore what man lost.
Yes.
Matthew chapter 4, verse 17 is the first public statement of Jesus. As a matter of fact, he was 30 years old. He had just come out of the wilderness. He's been tested for 40 days. He's out of the wilderness now. And the Bible says he came out of the wilderness with the Holy Spirit upon him in
That's
fullness.
Right.
His first public statement, Matthew 4, verse 17.
May I read it?
Yes.
From that time Jesus
forward, began to preach
quote, and to say,
yes,
repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Now, let me just say a word for those of you in the Western world. I was born under a kingdom here in the Bahamas. In 1959, we were under the United Kingdom of Great Britain.
Yeah.
So most of our experience here as children were under a kingdom concept. The kingdom concept is completely opposite to a democracy. It's completely opposite to a republic. Christ came preaching a kingdom, not a republic, not a democracy. Now, notice, he said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The word at hand is an old English statement from the 16th century. It actually means has arrived.
So you're saying there is no democracy in the kingdom of God?
Well, let me put it this way. A kingdom is opposite to a democracy.
It's a theocracy.
In a kingdom, there is no vote. In a democracy, the power is in the vote. In a democracy, in a republic, you have a president or a prime minister. In a kingdom, you have a king. In a democracy, you elect your leader. In a kingdom, the king elects the citizens.
Boy, we have the whole thing messed up here, don't we? In the church, I mean, things are not run like that.
Absolutely. So here's what's important here. In a democracy, for example, the Constitution is a result of the people's thoughts. For example, in America, Your constitution begins like this, we the people. But in this kingdom, it begins, I the Lord. In a kingdom, the king's word become the constitution. In a democracy, the people's words become the constitution. In a kingdom, the king's word becomes law. In a democracy, the people create the law. That's why they can change it. In a kingdom, as a citizen, you can't change the law. In a kingdom, the authority is not in a cabinet, it's in a person.
Wow.
In a democracy, it's in a cabinet. In a democracy, you can have a referendum and change a law. In a kingdom, you have no referendum. You don't change the law. That's why the Bible says, my word stands forever.
Amen.
So in a kingdom, and this is important, because you see, religion has become a democracy. It's not what Jesus intended.
Most churches are run like a democracy.
Well, you said that.
Well, of course, it's the truth.
Yeah. But I'm talking about religion generally as it is. Even Christianity has become a religion, and it's basically functioning. For example, if a king makes a statement, it becomes law.
Absolutely.
So when Jesus says, for example, fornication is a sin, that's a king speaking. You can't vote on that to change it.
Exactly.
If he says, as a king, you know, homosexuality is an abomination, which I quote from the Bible, if you disagree with that, you can't bring together 70 bishops and vote against that. That's democracy. So most of the people who are in Christianity, and I use that term very carefully here in the context of a religion, that's why they can actually change the laws. You know, we can actually say that, you know, well, God is not up to date. You know, he's not up to in step with what's going on. I mean, you know, we got problems in our society. We got emotional problems, hormonal problems, cultural problems. And so we got to update the Bible kind of thing. And so we get these theologians getting together and telling the king, I tell you what, we disagreed with what you said 2,000 years ago, so we're going to change it by vote. Mm. That's not a kingdom. So most of the people who are tampering with the Bible, they don't threaten me at all. As a matter of fact, I'm not too concerned about homosexual churches and, you know, all the different things that are going on. That's not a big deal for me, because those people are in a religion. They are not in the kingdom of God. Whoa. Whoa. Why do you think God took so long to send Jesus Christ? I asked that question for over 20 years. I couldn't figure that out. I mean, Adam fell 7,000 years ago, and Christ didn't show up until 4,000 years later. And now we're 2,000 years since that, moving into the 7,000 year.
Yeah.
Why did God wait for 4,000 years before he came in the flesh to restore man back? Because I believe the reason is because in order for you to communicate, there has to be the prototype of concepts again, which means that in order for him to explain to mankind what he intended man to become, he had to have concepts present to communicate those words, or those words communicate those concepts. So there was no kingdom concept like God's concepts when Adam fell. So every civilization and every kingdom that arose since Adam fell never had the prototype of the kingdom of heaven in it. A great, and I talk about this in the book, very important to understand this, every government since Adam fell never had the program that God intended for man. For example, whenever the Assyrians, the Babylonians, the Greeks, and the Chaldeans, all the kingdoms that followed the fall of Adam, whenever they invaded a territory, they would subdue the people, then they would uproot them and take them back to their countries and make them slaves. That was the style of warfare. You go into a country, you subdue it, you take the people, you bring them back to your country, you make them slaves. And if you study the scriptures and history, every kingdom did this except the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire was the first kingdom that whenever they subdued a people, they never took the people away from the country. They left them in the country, and they sent a governor from Rome in that country to make that country like Rome. That's what Pilate was. So that's why the Roman Empire became the most successful empire in history, because their system of government was similar to the kingdom of God. They kept their headquarters in Italy, in Rome, And they sent governors to all the different territories to make those territories just like Rome.
Yes.
That's why the statement is made, when in Rome, do as the Romans do. Because wherever you enter, if it's Roman territory, you are in Rome, even though you were never in Italy. Now we find the scripture saying, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son. In other words, fullness of time doesn't mean a time on a watch. It means everything is set in place.
Everything right.
It's perfect, right. Yeah. So God saw a prototype of the kingdom of heaven on earth, where you have a king with a kingdom being ruled through governors, not upwarding the people. The Roman Empire was built on that concept. Whatever is happening in Rome must show up in Palestine or in Africa. Or in London, in England, where they ruled. And they ruled the whole world for 2,000 years, all right? 200 years, rather. So these people are powerful, okay? And we have this system just like God's intent. God's intent was not really to come to earth. His intent was whatever is happening in heaven to happen on earth.
Oh.
He wanted to colonize earth with heaven through his children. The Bahamas is a great example of the kingdom's process. In the Bahamas, we are far away from England, but we were under the kingdom of Great Britain, and they colonized us. So in the Bahamas, you arrived here. Have you noticed? You drove on the left-hand side of the street.
Yeah.
That's from England. You know, when I grew up, I wore short pants, long socks, and a suit. That's British. We drink tea, not coffee. You know, we eat with knives and forks here. We speak English, you know. Come on, no fellow. You know,
yes.
we in other words, whatever the kingdom is, the
you
colony
exactly.
becomes.
Exactly.
So when they asked Jesus, how should we pray? He said, pray like this. Our Father, who is not on earth, holy is his name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth. Just like it is in heaven.
And when people pray that prayer and say, thy kingdom come, in their mind is, come, Lord Jesus.
Right.
But you're saying this is not what he meant.
No, a kingdom is the governing influence of a king over a territory, impacting it with his will and his intent and his purpose.
I think this message needs to be preached over and over and over and over again. Is that the reason why so many are powerless?
Absolutely. Let me tell you, that's an important question. Do you know that the only person that Jesus recognized as having great faith was not an Israelite?
Oh, that's right.
He was a man representing a kingdom.
The Roman.
Because you see, kingdom is not a religion. This centurion that Jesus met had a problem. And he came to Jesus not because he was a religious man. He came to Christ because he knew he was a kingdom man. He said, look, you don't need to come to my house. Because in kingdoms, the same way a Pilate had the thumb of Caesar. You know, I can give you life, I can take it away. Even though I'm far away from Italy, he says, I have the power to take your life or give it to you. Why? Because when you represent a kingdom, the authority of the king is distributed through his servants.
Amazing.
So that you don't need to go and check the headquarters to get things done. You can get it done on the local scene. So that's why to get healed, we don't need to go to heaven. You are an ambassador of heaven, a government. An ambassador is not a religious creature. It's a political appointment. And you are ambassadors of Christ. Ambassadors carry, let me tell you something about ambassadors. It's very important. In the book, I talk about this. Ambassadors are not religious people. And the scriptures, can I use another term?
Yes.
This constitution says that we are ambassadors of Christ. That means we've been appointed by the government of heaven to represent the kingdom of heaven on earth.
So say what you're going to say about the ambassador.
An ambassador is not a person.
I want to know what I am. That's why I just asked him that.
An ambassador is not a person. And we got some in this room. You know, we got a number of people who were ambassadors officially of government. They would tell you this. An ambassador is an embodiment of a country.
Whoa. Say that again.
Yes. An ambassador is an embodiment of a country.
He carries
the country. He is the country. Let me explain what I mean. Very important. Because it helps you understand how great your power is, but you don't realize it. If you are a parliamentarian or a congressman or a senator, you're not really great. The ambassador is greater than you.
Wow.
If I had a choice between being an ambassador versus a parliamentarian, a congressman, a senator, or city councilman, I'd go for being an ambassador for important reasons. One, when you appoint an ambassador, you've made that person a walking country. Number two, you take over their lives completely. An ambassador pays no bills. The minute a government appoints you an ambassador, the government becomes responsible for your food, your clothes, your ride, your cars, your houses, your children's tuition. In other words, your life becomes the property of the government.
That's amazing.
That's why Jesus said to the disciples, why do you worry what you will eat, what you will drink, what you will wear? Jesus,
my God, whoa. That are making my goosebumps feel goosebumps right now. Wow. You know, you've answered so many questions, and we got 3 minutes left, and we got to go on tomorrow. I want to ask you tomorrow what Jesus said, the kingdom of God is within you.
Absolutely.
What that means. I had no idea an ambassador. Can I have a praise break? Thank you, Jesus. I had no idea that an ambassador had more authority than one who's a member of parliament.
If you slap an ambassador,
what happens?
Watch this. 2 minutes, let's close on this.
Please.
Okay. If I'm a citizen and you're an ambassador, same country.
Uh-huh.
If someone slaps me, it is called an assault or an insult.
Right.
An assault or an insult. But if they slap you as an ambassador, then the word changes. It is called an international incident.
Whoa. Whoa. Whoa.
So that's what Jesus meant when he says, if anyone offends you, it is better for them to tie a rope around their necks. Why? Because they are touching a country and the government is going to come and take care of them.
My God. Not miss. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, my God. My head is buzzing, my heart is blowing, bubbling up. You know, David said, my heart is intending a good thing, and I feel it all over me. Listen, you got to get this book, and don't miss the program tomorrow, because he will be talking about that and more.